Hello everyone, it's me again in a new episode of Med the Expert series. Today we have Professor Christopher Barrat from University of Dundee. He's the head of Division Systems Medicine and the Reproductive Medicine Group at the University of Dundee. If you'd like to know more about him, I will leave a link in the description. Today we will discuss another male fertility issue, which is varicoceles. So what is varicoceles and how it affects male fertility and should it be treated or not? So we will know the answer for these questions from Professor Christopher Barrat. But before I go, you know what you have to do. You have to go down, press on the subscription and press like. One more thing, if you'd like to see the previous videos, you can check the link in the description as well. Hi, Professor Barrat. Thanks for accepting my invitation and be here again with us.
Hey, I would like good to be here. Good to be here, Audie. Good to be here.
Thank you. Thank you. So today I would like to discuss with you a very common cause of male infertility, which is varicoceles. So what is varicoceles and how it does affect male fertility and whether you support or not treating varicoceles. But before we start, maybe as a term, varicoceles might be not clear for everyone. So could you start by explaining what is varicoceles?
It's primarily an abnormal dilation of the veins in the piriform plexus that takes blood from the testis, and they're graded depending on the severity. So sometimes they're very small and hardly noticed, and the grade 4 one is one where they call a classic, they call it a bag of worms, so it's really very, very noticeable. So they come in different sort of gradations, really. They're primarily on the left-hand side, 80 to 90% of cases. Usually for an introduction that actually it's a common cause of male infertility. I mean, that's disputed. it's slightly controversial, I think, and has been for the past part of 25 years, really. Its actual role in spermatogenesis, it's whether you treat it, does it work, yes or no. It is quite controversial, but that's the definition. So that's answering your first question, I guess.
Yeah. So yeah. We'll talk about the common treatment later.
It's common. That's true. Yeah, it is common.
Yeah, so like you said, it's common, but like how common it is between the population or within the infertile men? Yeah.
So it depends on what type of criteria you look at. But, you know, fertile men varicoceles, and somehow quite a severe varicocele. So the approximate statistics would be two-thirds of men, fertile men with a varicocele, would obviously achieve a conception naturally. So they are not regarded as an absolute factor for infertility. If you looked at, say, the largest set of data is from the European Urology Society, and they've got data on about 10,000 men, and they suggest that in azoospermia, it's about 14-15% with a varicocele. So it's higher in a subfertile population compared to a fertile population, and the severity is higher in those two groups, but it's not an absolute factor. You can have a varicocele and still achieve a conception.
Yeah, so as you mentioned now, there are some people achieving pregnancy, but they still have varicoceles. So what are the symptoms and signs? Like how, if I have varicoceles, how would I know that?
Well, a subclinical one that you may not know. You may have some pain, for example, some very small swelling. If you've got a significant varicocele, it's obvious. So that's that classic bag of worms effect. So you would see that, and it'd be primarily on your left-hand side body. So I think individuals may know. Once you then go to an infertility clinic, then have a physical examination and history, that would be picked up. And then if you'd be, you generally, and this is general but not absolute, if you've got a large varicocele, a grade 4 varicocele, for example, and you're in a subfertile category, they may then refer you to a urologist. That's commonly done in many countries. Not so much in the UK, actually, but commonly done in other countries. And other countries, and urologists then primarily would probably then think about potential treatment, which could be surgery, for example, to then do a surgical reconstruction, to then presumably reduce the reduce the varicocele or get rid of it. And then the idea then is that there should be a recovery of spermatogenesis, so maybe your sperm count go up or sperm motility will go up. And in theory, then you've got a higher chance of pregnancy. And that's really where the controversy comes in. I think there are plenty of papers to demonstrate if you've got a large varicocele, there's a significant association with poor sperm quality and, for example, with DNA damage in the sperm. And then when that's then reversed, so treated primarily by surgery, then there's probably a reduction in DNA damage and there's an increase in sperm counts. Whether then that leads to a significant increase in pregnancy rates, again, the data is slightly controversial about that. I think it's my opinion from just looking at the data would be that if you've got a very significant varicocele, it's well worth going to see a urologist. And on a balance of probabilities, it's probably best to consider surgery with the urologist. That is no guarantee of success, but on the balance of probabilities, it's probably wise to do that.
Yeah, so you think like if the male has infertility issues or pain, they should go to do it, but otherwise there's no need.
Otherwise, no. I think otherwise, because unless it's causing pain and et cetera, and unless it's picked up in early adolescence, there's probably less indication to go for surgery. But sometimes it can be a cosmetic reason as well, even if there's no pain, for example. So it's a large subject matter, because it's a one word. Very complicated thing's been around for a long time. But in a subfertile population with a significant varicocele, I think there is an opportunity just to consider surgery.
Yeah, so as I
understand, support in that, not concrete.
Yeah, the thing, but as I understand, you said there is improvement in DNA fragmentation, and
that's
is there any improvement in?
Yeah.
Is there an improvement in motility or sperm concentration?
Well, I think that, you know, the variability in how those assays are done. But I think there is evidence for some improvement in semen characteristics. Morphology is one that people usually go for, but of course that's quite controversial how you assess it. I think the key thing is that the hypothesis is that the varicocele, maybe through temperature and or through high levels of reactive oxygen species, would damage then sperm in the testis and damage spermatogenesis and damage sperm in the epididymis. So the argument then would be, well, removing that would reduce that damage. Therefore, for example, that's why possibly you see a reduction in DNA damage in you've had the surgery.
Is there any other treatment than doing the surgery? Like, antioxidants or things would help?
Well, I think there is some data that, but the antioxidants don't, is probably another subject. Surgery is a primary factor, and whether that's keyhole surgery, open surgery, that surgery is the primary factor.
Okay, that's great, and we got...
You could do IVF, though. People have IVF, obviously, and ICSI, but you could have IVF and ICSI with or without a...
Yeah, but I mean, like, if a male with very low concentration and motility, and they notice that he has a varicocele, would he go?
I think if you've got a significant, that's a personal choice, really. I think the advantage going for varicocele correction by surgery for a good urologist would be that, in theory, you've got a more permanent solution. Whereas it always, if you go for IVF, it's a one-off event. You know, you're going for egg collection. Once the embryos are used up, that's it. So the advantage of, it's the same story of vasectomy reversal. You know, if you go for a reversal, then you've always got sperm present, hopefully. Whereas if you just go for IVF and you get sperm from the testis rather than changing your, doing a vasovasostomy, then, you know, you've got a one-off event. So it's always the same type of calculation for individual.
Also, if he has been or not, that's another thing as well. Thank you. That was very interesting topic, and we cover almost everything we need. And we'll have you again.
Simple answers, I'm afraid.
Yeah, simple answer, but very useful.
Yeah, hopefully it's helpful.
Thank you very much. I will have you again another time.
Okay.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.